What is the United Nations? It is a constant work in progress. It tries to open doors to the remedies against the worst problems of mankind.
The abject poverty, health issues, lack of access to education, gender equality, and violence. Those are all the challenges the whole international community is now facing to address.
Never before in history have people and governments wielded as much power over their destiny and their planet. In an increasingly interdependent and globalizing world, the United Nations symbolizes and advocates the multilateralism of our emerging era.
The United Nations helps all of us in reaching our collective goals on security, on peace, on development, and stabilizing the world to be a better place.
We believe that the global problems requires a multilateral attention, that the value of the United Nations is precisely this.
Multilateralism, or working together, is one of the main goals of the United Nations, and its main multilateral forum is the General Assembly. The General Assembly was devised after World War II as a great equalizer, where each of the 192 member states holds one vote.
In the General Assembly, you don't reach a resolution or a decision immediately. Usually, it takes some time to debate on it, to evaluate it, exchange views. Some member countries then come up with proposals. So it's an ongoing process until you have a decision. All these thematic meetings, high-level meetings, were geared to achieving something.
Although the decisions and resolutions of the General Assembly hold no legally binding force for governments, they symbolically carry the moral authority and weight of the world community. Stewarding the General Assembly is far from an easy job. From September 15, 2007 to September 14, 2008, His Excellency Dr. Srgjan Kerim was president of the 62nd session of the General Assembly.
The role of the president of the Assembly is a very unique role. He needs to bring all the members, 192 tribes, together. It's not an easy job. And therefore, he needs to be a unifier, not a polarizer, in order to get anything done.
President Kerim's background was uniquely suited to revitalize the role. He was the first president of the General Assembly to have a background in both diplomacy and business.
It is his brilliant diplomatic career linked later with a very successful business career in media. It's a unique opportunity to have experience from both sides.
He knows member states, their different priorities and preoccupations, drawing on his time when he was a permanent representative here himself. He has had the ability to articulate what are the big issues that matter most for the General Assembly. And he's been very fair, which is absolutely essential in commanding the respect of ambassadors and delegations here.
Secretary General Ban Ki-moon recognized a kindred spirit in President Kerim.
One day, both I and he had spent the whole night through until 6 a.m. next morning, when we were discussing and debating the very important budget matter. That much he has shown a strong commitment and dedications. And I have been very fortunate to have worked with such a great leader of General Assembly.
President Kerim devoted his energies to four principal areas. The first was climate change, which he placed at the center of the international agenda.
I call to order the thematic debate of the General Assembly entitled Addressing Climate Change, the United Nations and the World at Work.
Climate change is not just an environmental issue. It's a security issue, it's an economic issue, it's a societal issue. We've made a step change in the last 12 months in the world's appreciation of the scale of the challenge we face on climate change, and a lot of that's been down to what's happened in this building.
The UN cannot address climate change alone. We need as many actors as possible to get involved in order to address its effects.
I think the President of the General Assembly this year has helped to move this agenda towards an agreement on stabilization of greenhouse gases towards consensus.
He took his concern onto the smallest countries, the countries which are isolated, the countries which are least developed, the countries which have more difficulties and suffer more from the climatic changes.
We need to reconcile the economic aspirations of developing countries with the necessity to reduce greenhouse gas emissions.
He especially pointed out that huge, maybe over 80% of the effort should be done by private sector in order to solve the problem of climate change.
Are we willing enough to change our lifestyles and patterns of behavior? And globally, are we making adequate efforts to adapt to the long-term effects of climate change? Ultimately, we will have to answer some demanding questions of ourselves.
President Kerim's efforts did not go unnoticed. When his term as president was over, the Secretary General would appoint him special envoy for climate change. The second area on which Dr. Kerim focused his attention was the ongoing United Nations effort to help the Third World. Here, he brought his experience and contacts in the business world to bear.
We had some business sector organizations coming. We had the Microsoft spoke. We had Pepsi Cola. We had all business sector companies coming to speak. This was new in the General Assembly.
He had Mayor Bloomberg. He had Arnold Schwarzenegger. He had all sorts of specialists come to the UN. And that's interesting for member states. So it enlivens us, and it also expands the influence of the UN in the outside world.
President Kerim recognized the value of star power in illuminating these issues. He brought in a parade of A-list celebrities to speak before the General Assembly.
Ms. Jha provided an important piece of guidance for all of us here today that work on this issue and other forms of human injustice demands both a rational as well as an emotional commitment.
And, for the first time in 30 years, the biggest star of all.
Your presence here today, Your Holiness, is a very powerful recognition of the validity and importance of international institutions, particularly of the United Nations.
I think it's very, very, very important that today our discussions are much more many-sided because we are having these other parties too, and not just, you know, as ambassadors.
When you have an actress speaking about human trafficking, when you have private sector companies coming to see how can they help build better strategy in dealing with the issue of food crisis. This kind of right mix between political aspects and the outside society, business sector, NGOs, and civil society, I think that this was a very good, successful story.
Third, the president addressed terrorism. For years, the United Nations has struggled to respond to this issue.
I think that member states all regard terrorism as a common challenge. But as how to deal with this issue, since all member states are from different parts of the world, with different background, with different culture, so therefore, the way to implement this strategy, the member states might have different views.
President Kerim demanded that the General Assembly focus on deliverables.
In a world full of controversies which can escalate into conflicts, violence and atrocities, effective multilateralism remains our goal so as to achieve peace and stability on Earth.
America's main man in the General Assembly, former New York Governor George Pataki, saw him in action and was impressed.
Dr. Kerim was really out there aggressively working to make sure that the General Assembly played its part in working to help with money laundering, to help with having the appropriate sanctions against individuals or entities that have financed or supported terrorism in the past. And I think he should be given very real credit for bringing to a very broad and diverse group of countries the sense of common purpose when it came to fighting terrorism.
Even the United Nations' greatest supporters have admitted that the UN is a flawed system. President Kerim was determined to tackle those flaws. He started in his own backyard, with the massive pileup of mandates, or issues, that had accumulated on the General Assembly's plate over the years.
If you say that you want the General Assembly to become effective, you can't still have 9,600 mandates and agenda of the General Assembly. So he has been leading effort to reduce these mandates to 2,000, 3,000 mandates on the agenda. So as the General Assembly will have much more time in order to reflect better and to take better decisions on these aspects.
Over the last 60 years, the world has changed considerably and had a huge impact on the role of our organization. We now need to renew and retool this organization so that it can rise to the challenges and evolving needs of the 21st century. We have a critical window of opportunity to accelerate progress by translating our commitments into action.
The United Nations is about working together, and everyone agreed that President Kerim helped unite the nations of the General Assembly.
To everybody, it's clear the General Assembly has now new life, is more focused.
I simply had my highest respect and esteem for the man, for his decisiveness, dynamism, and proactivism.
We are sure that this year, that has been marked by him as the President of the General Assembly, will be remembered as a very important year in the history of the United Nations.
He has been a good president, a successful president of the General Assembly. I personally will miss him because he's been a good friend, and I look forward for working with him down the road.
My understanding of diplomacy is that you should, as a diplomat, always try to open doors, to enter spaces, rooms. But very often doors are closed. So in such cases, you have to use the window. And even if the windows are closed, there is a third chance for you, that's the chimney.
We must not be remembered as the generation that betrayed rather than honored our commitments. We need more just multilateralism based on peace and tolerance with the United Nations at its heart.